and welcome to the Dewey Decibel System, the official podcast of the Buchanan District Library in Buchanan, Michigan. I'm Meg Paulette Perez. I'm the director of the library and one of your hosts, along with the gruesome twosome, Karen Gonzalez and Grant Wagner. Hey, Karen. Hey, Grant.
Hi.
Hello.
All right. Are you guys ready for this extra special, extra spooky episode we have here today?
I am.
Are you guys fans of the season and all the spooky stuff, or is it?
I love spooky stuff. I do not like to get scared, which is
like
weird.
Really scared.
Yeah, like yeah. I've never even. Okay, guys, spoiler. I've never been to the Niles Haunted House.
I know we were talking about this yesterday. Neither have I.
You like, guys have never been.
No, it's too so scared. Fun. I'm way too scared.
I'm not gonna pay someone to scare me. That's not the feeling I'm.
That's
going
a really
for.
Good way to put it. That's
it's the adrenaline rush.
Yeah. All right, so in case anyone out there is listening for the first time, let me tell you how our show works. Karen, Grant, and myself all work here at the library, and on each episode, we get together to talk about books, movies, TV shows, music, video games, or pretty much anything we want to, but we have to have checked out the thing we're talking about with our Buchanan library card. Lucky for us, you can get almost anything with your library card because your card doesn't just let you check out stuff here at our library. You can also get things from libraries all over the state through Interlibrary Loan, also known as MelCat. You can check out digital books, music, movies, and more on Libby and Hoopla. And you can use your card at other libraries nearby that Buchanan cardholders have reciprocal borrowing privileges at. Each month, we have a different special guest join our conversation, and this month's special guest is local VIP Bobby Blaylock. Firefighter Bobby, as you may know him, has been on the Buchanan City Fire Department for 31 years and is now the assistant chief in charge of all fire prevention activities here in town. Bobby is an all-around friend of the library, and we are very happy to have him on the show today. Before we get to our conversation, though, we're going to talk to another library staff member about some upcoming programs that are going to be so much fun, it's scary. So stick around, and we'll be right back with that. All right, we're back with Jen, the evil queen of all things programming around here. And she's going to tell us about some upcoming programs that you're not going to want to miss. So hi, Jen. Tell us all about it.
Hey, how's it going? So yeah, I am the evil mistress of programming here at the library. I have the fun job. Mm-hmm. And we are trying something different for the first time this year called Murder in the Stacks. It's an interactive murder mystery event where participants become the detectives, mm-hmm. trying to solve a murder of a local librarian.
Oh no.
I know. It might be someone you know.
Wait, I'm not on the hook for this again, am I? No. Remember I had to get murdered for the Greta's program over the summer?
Yeah, no, you already paid your time,
okay,
so
good.
I'll make
someone else can get murdered.
I was the murderer.
Oh, that's right. Karen killed me.
Yeah.
You look Karen. Like a murderer.
Because I wanted your job, wasn't it? Oh, that's literally what they
there
did.
There was a whole thing. But anyway, sorry, Jen.
Spoiler, Karen is not the murderer.
I'm not.
Okay,
yeah.
We have actors from the Tin Shop, and they are going to be playing all the suspects, and there will be investigating and interrogating, mm-hmm. and there will be puzzles to solve. So it'll be a really fun time.
And when is it?
That is Friday, October 18th, from 7 to 9 p.m. after the library closes.
Cool. Very cool. And you do have to call us to sign up ahead of time, right?
Yes. Please call so that I have enough case files printed up.
Yeah, because it's a limited space. We can't just take, you know, 100 people or anything like that. It has to be a reasonable number. So
yeah,
there's a good list going, but there's still a little bit of room.
Yeah, there's
left.
Still a little bit of room.
So if that's your kind of thing, so it's kind of like Clue, but like with real people.
Kind of like, you know, have you ever heard of those murder dinner parties?
Oh, okay.
You know, where someone gets murdered and then they have to figure it out. It's kind of the same thing, except the person's already been murdered and there's no dinner.
Oh. You're not really selling. I think there'll be some snacks.
There will be snacks.
There'll
yes, be snacks. But I'm not making a 3-course meal.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, maybe I'll next year. One. Maybe next year. Okay, cool. Well, that sounds cool and creepy. What else do we got coming up?
So the Berrien County Historical Association has a program called "Never Walk Safely Again," which is kind of a hype title.
Yeah, I think we kind of just, for us, on our web, we could just called it a murder story.
Yes, because
that's a really intense title.
Yeah, so. No, it's a little scary. Yeah. But it explores the murder of a Benton Township man in 1904 and how the investigator Ivering Pearl didn't stop until it was solved.
Yeah.
So it's going to be, you know, if you like history and you like, you know, kind of cold cases, true crime, this is for you. It's Thursday, October 24th at 5:30.
Cool. Very nice. Very nice. And then I know it'll be a little bit after Halloween, but it kind of feels like it's in the spirit. We have another upcoming program, right?
Yeah. So it's a virtual program. Andrew Kircher is doing an event on cryptids, and it's called Cryptids Decrypted. So it's figuring out, like, you know, if you had to describe a kangaroo to someone who had never seen a kangaroo before.
Well, because tell us what a cryptid is, because I hadn't necessarily heard that term before.
A cryptid is a, I don't want to say mythical creature, but it's like a, it's an unexplained.
Yeah. So examples would be Bigfoot, the Loch Ness Monster.
Yeah. And then there's people have found cryptids that really exist, but they're not, you know, cryptids anymore.
Right. Like giant squid.
Like giant squid.
Right. Okay.
Or, you know, for,
they used to think those weren't real.
My favorite example is kangaroos, because if you had to describe a kangaroo to someone who had never seen a kangaroo, you're like, oh yeah, it jumps like 8 feet in the air and it has really big, you know, it's like,
and it'll punch you in the face.
Yeah, you're like, what kind of animal in its belly? You're like, wait, this is an animal? No, this doesn't exist. And then you're like, oh, it actually does.
Or like a platypus or something.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah. Okay. So this is, it's decrypting some of those cryptids that they thought didn't exist, but now they do.
Okay,
so
I feel like that's kind of in the season, too. Yeah, it's not exactly creepy, but I thought that was cool.
Oh, it's definitely creepy.
So I wanted to mention that. So, yeah, we got Murder in the Stacks, A Murder Story, and Cryptids Decrypted coming up, among many, many other programs.
Oh, yeah, no.
So don't worry, we got you around here if you're saying come and
too
learn
many events.
Interesting things. So, okay. Well, thank you, Jen, for coming and sharing about some of that stuff. Well, we're definitely going to check it out. We're back again, and before we dive into our picks for this episode, we need to meet our special guest, Bobby Blaylock. Hey, Bobby, welcome to the podcast.
Good morning. How are we doing this morning?
Whew, okay, it's still kind of early, but we're so happy to have you here. Before we get started, you know, I know you're basically Buchanan famous, but in case anyone hasn't met you, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I've been married for a lot of years, like over 30 years. I can never remember how many years. Don't tell Julie that. But anyway.
It's a good thing this isn't recorded or anything.
Yeah. And been on the fire department, well, not quite as long as I've been married, but it's, been the assistant chief for probably 12 years and just have all kinds of interests. Love to fish, love to do all kinds, spend time with my grandkids and my wife and That's about as exciting as I get right there. So.
Well, another exciting thing, right after we're done with this, you're going to go down to our story time, and it's always so cute, because do you do the thing where you dress up and all the stuff so they can, it's still me, it's still me.
Yeah, the kids will bring a truck over, and I do sort of a little thing on Facebook. It's called the Big Red Truck, and the kids just, of course, just love it. Mm-hmm. So. So we will be down there. That should be 11 o'clock that we do that story time.
Yep.
So I get to read a book and, visit with the kids. So.
All right. Well, thank you so much for being here. We've got some all of us have picked spooky types of things this month. I'm sorry, because it is October, so, you know, that's like the law or something. We have to do that. And we are going to kick it off this time with the scariest guy I know, Grant Wagoner.
All right.
All right, Grant, tell us what you brought for us to talk about today.
So, first off, I need to mention, I was going to do Conjuring, but someone didn't let me pick that.
The movie?
Yeah,
there's no way. Karen's with me on this one, too, now that I know we're both wimps.
Yeah, so I picked three books from the Michigan Chiller series by, what's his name?
Jonathan Rand.
Yeah, Jonathan. I knew it was Rand. I'm tired this morning.
Yeah.
Also known as Christopher Wright, Jonathan Rand is his pseudonym.
Oh, I didn't know that. So that's not his actual name. Okay.
Yeah, so his real name is Christopher Wright. So I chose three of these today because they're pretty short reads. They're basically large print chapter books.
Yeah, because they're for about what age group would you say that these are kind of geared towards?
I was reading them in fifth grade, so I'd say about right. 5 through 8 would read them.
Yeah.
But they weren't that scary. Like, the scare level is probably like a 6.
So tell us some of the titles. Like, what are Michigan Chillers?
So Michigan Chillers are chilling books from all around Michigan. So the three I picked are Mackinac City Mummies, Gruesome Ghouls of Grand Rapids, and Creepy Clowns of Kalamazoo. So I tried to cater them to more places we all know and most people have been through, too. So just we can make more of a setting of it in our minds.
Yeah, definitely.
So...
Well, I read the Creepy Clowns of Kalamazoo. Which one did you read, Karen?
I read the Mackinac City Mummies.
Yeah. Because you're right. I picked the one because I knew I wouldn't have time to read all of them. I've been to Kalamazoo a lot. Like, I kind of know Kalamazoo, so I was like, oh, that would be that.
Did you recognize any places?
Well, okay, so the Creepy Clowns one completely takes place in, like, a carnival, so no, because it's basically just set up in, like, a field, so it's just wherever. so, yeah, that kind of took away a little bit of the fun with that one.
Yeah.
But, they do mention Kalamazoo a little bit.
I never been to Mackinac City.
Really?
So I don't know what I'm seeing.
Nope.
Yeah, I read Mackinac City, and that's a good one.
I thought they were actually somewhat scary. I was actually a little surprised.
Really?
Well, at first, I mean, I was trying to get into the mindset of, like, maybe, because the character is a 12-year-old girl, so I was trying to, like, okay, if I was 12, would I find this scary?
Yeah.
And probably yes, because I was a wimp then, and I'm a wimp now. But, yeah, it was... At first, I thought it was just going to be like, oh, here's this sort of scary thing, but then it's okay. Oh, here's this sort of scary thing, but then it's okay. Like, that none of it was really real. But then it kind of took a turn where it was actually sort of scary. Like, I don't know how much you want me to give away about the clowns are robots. Okay, sorry. That's it.
Ooh.
Spoiler alert. They're evil robots. And I was like, whoa. Because I thought that it was all going to be like, oh, I was just... tricking myself, and none of this was actually scary for a minute.
But then it was,
then it was like, okay, no, we're really, the clowns are gonna like take our brains, and like it's bad.
And I feel like this creepy clowns, it also gives off like the real fear of clowns. Like,
clowns are scary.
No, I agree.
Like we could have talked about it. Like,
oh. Okay, but you're
Bobby, like, yeah. Bobby's nodding his head. Like, it would have been a contender for this show. Are you a fan?
Oh, it. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
But it's like, clowns are scary. I was at a parade the other day for Apple Fest, and a clown just starts walking towards us. I'm like, no, not doing this.
Yeah.
I don't know. I look at clowns, and I'm like, duh, I wear makeup, but just... I don't see how that
but
is
also,
fun whatsoever.
Yeah, but also, who's under the makeup?
Dun, dun, dun.
Like, that's what's, that's what's scary. You don't know their intentions.
Yeah.
I mean, to make kids laugh.
Yeah.
Until they're evil. I don't know.
Yeah, I wonder what the history is of clowns. I'm not going to know the answer to this at all.
But
like,
that?
When did who was the first evil clown? Was Stephen King the originator?
No,
of that?
I think it was
that
John
murderer.
Wayne Gacy.
There you go.
Oh, okay.
So that's he was like, asking. We're not, this is too deep for this episode. We're not going to talk about him.
Okay. Well, so the creepy clowns one. So what was the, you read the Mackinac City one. What was it? Mackinac City?
Mummies.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one, I don't even remember it, to be honest. It was so much.
So I like Mackinac City Mummies because it also has some history in it about just, it talks about mummies, which are ancient beings, and they're also like emerging in a small American town. And how did that happen?
Yeah.
Where did they come from? So that one's really good. And that one takes place with Paige and Devin, who are pretty young. All of the kids in these stories are, like, probably 10 to 15.
Okay, yeah.
So they're all pretty young.
But to be honest, like, a mummy, think about that. A dead person coming back to life and just walking.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm good.
They're wrapped in, like,
I see. I thought you were going to say it got into the history of Mackinac City. Does it? Not really? No.
Okay. I mean, it talks about Mackinac City, but not like the history of it.
Okay. Yeah. Did you know that after he got done doing these Michigan chillers, he started doing American chillers?
I did know
and
that.
And that's like a bigger thing now. So
yeah.
There's all over the country, like this is kind of his thing now.
So now he just gets paid to travel and make scary stories.
Yeah.
I know.
I was thinking about that, but like to actually make a story good would be like really hard. Like it takes a certain talent and a lot of time management skills
and,
to do that.
And for this age group, like I think that it's I think it's really important books that are at about this level. Mm-hmm. I was talking to my kid about this yesterday, who's 16 now, but it's like there's that weird age, and Bobby, maybe you know about this a little bit because your grandkids are kind of in that age right now, where it's like all little kids love picture books. Like you're never going to meet a little kid who doesn't love to sit down and read a story with you. But then that transition between picture books and like being a grown-up reader can be difficult for a lot of kids, and there's not always – it can be hard to find them books that they really love at that age. You know, and I think these are good ones. You know, I definitely remember working in the elementary school and kids wanted to check these out, you know, and they wanted the goosebumps and they wanted the being scared is fun, like at that age, you know, it feels kind of grown up. And anyway, so like I know sorry, now I'm blanking on your
Bailey.
Yeah, I know she likes those dragon books.
Yeah. We just bought her the whole set, but we've been she gets impatient, you know, she comes to get them at the library and going like, oh, they're in a way.
Right, because they're popular.
Because they're popular. And but yeah, so far as her mom sort of grew up with the first ones you had mentioned.
The Goosebumps.
The Goosebumps, And that was a big thing. And then, but just sort of anything, sort of murder mystery type thing. My grandkids sort of had a rite of passage that's how they got a Niles Scream Park jersey or whatever.
So they like
hoodie.
They like the Scream Park.
So
then,
as they got older, I kept telling Travis, I was going, no, you got to wait. You got to wait till you go to the haunted house to get the whole experience.
So what's the age that they finally get to go to?
About nine, he finally went. But Bailey and I were going together for a couple years. Yeah. And then, you know.
She's tough, though. She likes spiders and snakes. And like.
He's like,
she's more of the Michigan Chillers type. She's not going to be reading, you know. But I got to say, the kind of reading that they, you know, that they did or do compared to, you know, I don't know if you remember the readers that we had, which was
See
Dick Run,
Dick and Jane,
See
kind of,
Jane,
right.
And I was going like, if they read this, they would go like, how old were you when you, I was like 15 when I started reading like that.
Right. Well, I mean, so that's the thing, like getting books that kids are actually going to get kind of hooked on.
Right.
Because I think that transition is a really important age, and a lot of kids don't necessarily make that leap. They love picture books, but then it's, you know, you got to get them over that hump. And so I think that, you know, getting kids into things like this and having books out there like it is great. I'm a fan.
Yeah, but I mean, the good thing is they're not that scary.
They're suspenseful. Like every chapter ended with like, and then a hand reached out from the dark and grabbed me. Like every chapter was like, what's going to happen next? Yeah. Like he does a good job with that. Yeah. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, did you like it, Gretna?
Yeah, so these were like, I said I read these in fifth grade. So it's like, yes, these are childish books I'm picking, but also like when we talked about Diary of a Wimpy Kid, they bring us back to our childhood.
Right. Yeah.
And spookiness when we're children, it's crazy to see how like that was scary, but now it's like, it's not as scary. Like, what was I afraid of?
Yeah. Yeah.
But see, it's funny because these are like Michigan chillers and I'm from, I was raised in Indiana, and, like, I've never heard of these books. I only heard of, like, Goosebumps.
Yeah, so there's
like
not
that.
An Indiana equivalent of this?
I don't know.
There's not,
know.
Like, the Terra and Terra Haute or something like that.
Iguanas in Indianapolis.
It might be.
Yeah. I don't know. But
see, you could write those and then.
Boom.
Yeah, cool. All right. Well, thanks, Grant, very much for and anybody out there, especially with kids in that kind of like, you know, third grade to sixth grade, we would definitely recommend you come down here. We got quite a few of these Michigan chillers. I didn't check ahead of time, but yeah, we've got probably 20 at least of them. And come down and check them out. All right, so Karen, I have I didn't get to show you this yesterday, but I have a clip to play for Five Nights at for your pick. So let's listen real quick.
There's really nothing to worry about.
Oh! Close the door!
First day sea breeze, close the doors only if absolutely necessary.
Pause 37%, 2 a.m. You do the math.
Oh, this game is so creepy. Why is he in my face, though? Oh, this is not good, guys. Why am I even working here? What's gonna happen now? What's he doing? We're done. We're done because they didn't tell me about the power in the beginning. He was explaining! Don't do anything. Look away, guys. Everything will be okay if we can... What? What happened?
All right, Karen, tell us what we're talking about.
So, I chose Five Nights at Freddy's Decor Collection for the Switch. I got... this was actually one of, I think, our most circulated games here at the library. I really... am not into it. Like right now, it's this, like, it got really cool.
It's
like,
huge.
Yeah, like because of the movie, and you know they're coming out with books and stuff like that. So I was like, okay, we're doing spooky, so I will choose Five Nights at Freddy. So basically, Five Nights. Well, the core collection is a How do you guys say that?
Compilation.
Compilation. There you go. Of the first five games in the horror franchise. The game follows the story of Jeremy Fitzgerald and Mike Schmidt, two security guards who must survive the five nights working at Freddy Fazbear's Pizza, a family-friendly restaurant inhabited by animatronic characters that come to life at night.
I'm very proud of you for the way you said animatronic just now. Good job.
Because we were laughing about that yesterday.
Sorry,
I could not
sidebar.
Say that. But yeah,
perfect.
But yeah, so basically the gameplay, it's from like first person perspective. And basically you are a security guard. And you're like in at like one location, and you have security cameras, and so you have to keep looking through these security cameras to monitor the animatronics because they are trying to kill you. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like a puzzle game because you have to kind of you literally get no instructions. You start playing and you got to figure it out. You figure out how you're going to survive those five nights. So actually, me and Meg yesterday were playing it.
Terrible. We were dead real fast.
Yes. So yeah, because it was a long time since I actually played it. So we were playing it yesterday. And we were like, okay. And I've played it maybe twice because it's usually I used to have like family game night and my kiddos would play it, but really it would be my stepson and we would just kind of like sit back on the couch and let him do all the work and just get scared. So, but yesterday it was me and her. And we were like, okay, let's see how, you know, this is. We're playing, and then we're like, wait, why? What's this? There's, like, a caution sign. And then we didn't even know what was going on. Next thing I know, I'm dead. And I'm like, what the heck? And then there's, like, a battery percentage meter.
Some music box thing we had to, like, charge up. We're like, I don't know. Let's just keep doing
yeah.
it.
Yeah, and then there's, like, doors, and then yeah. another. And then so we were like, what the heck? And then there was a flashlight, the mask.
The
thingy.
Mask that you had to put on.
Yeah.
Because isn't that part of it? So it's not so much that they want to kill you. It's that they think that you're, like, supposed to be inside of a suit. And so if they find you, they're going to be like, oh, I'm going to stuff you back into one of these suits.
Yeah.
But then that's going to kill you.
Yeah. So that's why, like, that's one of the tactics. Like, if they're right in front of you, you would put the little mask on. And it's trying to trick them, like, oh, I'm one of you guys. Like, no, right, yeah. you know, just to survive the night. But really, it's kind of like, it's really strategy. You mm-hmm. have to figure it out. There's really no set way to play it. I mean, is not, because it's like, so you have your battery percentage. So the more that you look through the cameras, the more battery you're using. But you have to kind of look at the cameras because you need to know their location. But you can also not look at the cameras and look in front of you, because sometimes they can just kind of sneak up on you or on the doors on the side of you. Because we played, I believe, the first and the second one.
Right, yeah.
Because this one does come with five. It's like the other location. It's basically just different locations. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, so with that one, we were getting confused with the music box, like she was saying. We had to keep winding it up. I think if you don't, it comes out and gets you. Spoiler.
Oh, everything will get you. Yeah, spoiler alert.
Literally, no, because we were like, what's going on? Because when we both played it, we both were like at 5 o'clock. And then, yeah. Honestly, I let Meg play it. And I was like, you take it. She went further than me. So I give her, give her props. She almost made the whole night.
Almost, yeah.
And then
almost only counts in horseshoes and hands.
But somebody came to the desk. We were like, oh, sorry. And then so I had to like take over. And I was like, oh, I think we're going to make it. And then she was able to come back. And we made it through the first night. And it literally goes, yay, like little confetti. Mm-hmm. And we were just like, oh. And then boom.
Boom.
Yeah, second right night, back into right it. Back like, to okay, the work, great. Right? Yeah. And so we were like, oh, okay. But anyway, so another thing too, the animatronics, they are from the, like, it's from the pizza place, which is called the Fazbear, Freddy Fazbear. And so think of it as Chuck E. Cheese, like back in the day, sorry, people.
Showbiz. You know,
yeah,
showbiz,
you know, or showbiz.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, like the little, yeah, the things moved and stuff. That's what it is. Like,
it's, which were legitimately creepy. I don't know about you guys.
Yes, they were.
They were.
I haven't been to one in a long time now, yeah. But they were pretty.
They just took the ones in South Bend out, like maybe like 5 years ago. Because
the
now
one
they
down
put
in Mishawaka.
Yeah, because yeah. Mm-hmm. Now they have like a disco dance floor, and now they just put everything on TV. So you see like Chuck E. Cheese like dancing on there.
No more.
Yeah. But those things were creepy.
Maybe it's because of this game, because everybody went in and was like, kids are scared now.
I mean, who?
What about you, Grant? Did you go to Chuck E. Cheese when you were a kid? Were you scared of the...
My mom had the saying, Chuck E. Cheese is where kids get disease.
I always thought of it as like a casino for children.
Yeah. Oh, that's a new conspiracy that I've heard of, is that like all the flashing lights and all the noises make it a casino.
A lot of the games were basically like games at
chairs. I never even thought of it that way. Yeah.
I think I've been once, but my mom was very against them because they are... They're never cleaned, if you think about it.
You guys
it.
Are way too classy for a Chuck E. Cheese. Like, the Wagoners are classy people.
But I don't think I've... I think I've been to one once. Maybe I'll go this weekend.
I was part of the Chuck E. Cheese era when they had the ball pits.
Mm-hmm.
Love it.
Oh, the ball pits. Yeah, those were fun. But now it grosses everybody out.
Yeah. Well, there are also the Chuck E. Cheese pizza... allegations. Have you guys heard
no,
them?
No, but
that they reuse slices from old pizzas.
Oh, that's gotta be an urban legend. I'm defending Chuck E. Cheese here. I think it's a fine establishment.
Was it an animatronic that did it? Well, anyway.
Yeah,
so
back to this.
Back to Freddy.
What about playing it? Have you guys played it, or have you had any experience with this?
I've never played it. I've watched it, and it creeps me out.
This is creepy.
One thing that, like, yes, it's a kid's thing, but it scares me.
Yeah, I don't think it's really marketed necessarily as a kid's thing anymore.
No, it's not.
I don't know. I think it's now geared towards more PG-13-ish because... because I don't even know if they made it rated R, the new one. No.
Yeah, I don't know if it's...
They had to put PG-13. Yeah, because that's their target audience.
Yeah.
It is kind of... Because there is a movie, too, and we do have it here, guys.
the movie's pretty new, isn't it?
Yes. I think it came out like a year ago?
Yeah, I think so.
A year ago, because I just watched it. I'm not going to lie. I was like, that was, like, I knew that was going to happen. Like, the jump scares, I'm not going to lie, the jump scares on the movie, I was like, come on, you could have got, they got me only one time. I was like, oh, you could have got me more than once. And then this stupid game, I was like, I don't know if it's coming at me or not. I was scared of my Switch.
I believe there's a VR version.
Nope, I'm cool.
No, yeah. Thank you.
We should try that one time.
I played boxing one time and it was delicious. I'm not playing this. No.
That would be fun.
Yeah. No, the music's creepy, just their faces. Mm-hmm. The fact that you kind of have to, like you said, you go back and forth on the cameras and then it's like, wait, did one move? Did it move? I don't know. It's like it really messes with your brain. It's psychological.
Yeah, but the thing is too, so like I said, when you first play this game, you're literally just thrown into your first day at the job. So you literally don't know what's going on. But actually, the more nights that you progress, you'll start, because there's like radio sometimes, mm-hmm. and there's even like paper, like newspaper clippings that show. And if you actually pay attention, it's telling you the story. So because the pizza place, there's actually a dark past to it. And so you are actually trying to figure out the truth, because while the security guards are working there, they're figuring out that they're used, I guess, kids went missing. And, you know, and so that's why there were so many, I think, missing. And that's why.
Yeah, what is it? The bite of 87 or something? What does that mean?
I don't know. But I do know that, like, because I was reading it, too, that people really were that this, I guess there was an actual Chuck E. Cheese that was actually haunted, and this is where it came from. Okay. So I guess like the animatronics were actually like moving. I'm mm-hmm. like, I would have set that whole thing on fire.
Then Bobby would have had to come and put it out.
It's okay. Yeah. Teamwork. But yeah. So the story. So I guess it's you're working. The more you work there, the more you kind of find out. Mm-hmm. Like just the random calls. I don't even know who calls you, to be honest, because you just get random calls. You pick up.
I wondered that, because right away the phone is ringing. I'm like, how do I pick up this phone?
I don't know. I think it's just when you, like I said, when you play more, like in mm-hmm. the game, it just starts revealing more to you. And mm-hmm. you're like, wait, what? Because like I told you, you're not handed no instructions.
I did tell you that I liked that yesterday. As a video game adjacent person, I don't play a lot, but my husband does, and I watch him. And I know that an annoyance with newer games is over-explaining and just telling you way too much. There's no mystery. There's no, like, figuring it out. It's just walking you through everything step by step. So it's kind of cool that this one doesn't, and you have to just
out. Some people don't like that because they like to be handed a silver plate, you know?
Right. Mm-hmm. But then where's the challenge?
Exactly. Yeah. It's not a game then. Yeah. No. But yeah, with this one, yeah, it was it's scary. I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah.
And it's funner to play when it's you're in the dark with your little munchies, but just be careful because I do remember I spilled chips before. It's all fine.
Was it the classic popcorn?
Yeah, did you like throw it up in the air?
No, they were cheesy puffs. But close. Yeah. Just modern version.
Yeah.
But yeah.
All right. Well, I enjoyed getting a chance to give it a try. It was more fun than I thought, so thanks for showing us something a little new and different and spooky. Okay. Now, I have a spooky book to talk about with you guys, and I have a little clip to introduce it.
Harper Audio presents The Ocean at the End of the Lane by Neil Gaiman. Written and read by me, Neil Gaiman. I remember my own childhood vividly. I knew terrible things, but I knew I mustn't let adults know I knew. It would scare them. Maurice Sendak, in conversation with Art Spiegelman, The New Yorker, September 27th, 1993. It was only a duck pond out at the back of the farm. It wasn't very big. Letty Hempstock said it was an ocean, but I knew that was silly. She said they'd come here across the ocean from the old country. Her mother said that Letty didn't remember properly, and it was a long time ago, and anyway, the old country had sunk. Old Mrs. Hempstock, Letty's grandmother, said they were both wrong, and that the place that had sunk wasn't the really old country. She said she could remember the really old country. She said the really old country had blown up.
All right, so that was Neil Gaiman narrating the audiobook version of his book, The Ocean at the End of the Lane. I checked out and read the physical book from our library, but the audiobook version is available on Hoopla, and it's pretty cool that it's read by the author. So here's the synopsis. A middle-aged man returns to his childhood home to attend a funeral. He is drawn to the farm at the end of the road where, when he was 7, he encountered a most remarkable girl, Letty Hempstock. He hasn't thought of Letty in decades, and yet sitting by the pond, a pond that she claimed was an ocean, the unremembered past comes flooding back. 40 years earlier, a man committed suicide in a stolen car at the farm at the end of the road. Like a fuse on a firework, his death lit a torch paper and resonated in unimaginable ways. The darkness was unleashed, something scary and thoroughly incomprehensible to a little boy. And Letty, magical, comforting, wise beyond her years, promised to protect him no matter what. A groundbreaking work from a master, The Ocean at the End of the Lane is told with a rare understanding of all that makes us human and shows us the power of stories to reveal and shelter us from the darkness inside and out. A stirring and terrifying fable, as delicate as a butterfly's wing and as menacing as a knife in the dark. So I read this book, I reread it for the podcast, but I remember I read it originally around the time it came out in 2013, and I couldn't put it down. I started it like one night, stayed up way too late reading it, and then like finished it the next morning. I really enjoy the narration from a child's point of view. Somehow it really makes everything that much scarier. And Neil Gaiman in general is an author that I really enjoy. Some other books of his that you guys might be familiar with include Stardust, Good Omens, American Gods, The Graveyard Book, and of course Coraline, who in addition to being a library gecko, is also the title character of one of the creepiest and best-loved children's books written in recent years. So I really enjoy this book. It's short, it's scary, and it's sweet, and I really like it a lot. I'm curious to know what you guys thought of it.
I thought it was like you said, it was really cool, but it like it's kind of weird because of the whole mystery with the lake, because mm-hmm. like I lived by a pond and I like kind of looked at the same thing and I was like,
kind of freaked you out.
Well, because it's like the way that it is, it's like what I always thought, like what if a car just like phtoom, like mm-hmm. and nobody would know, like yeah. in case somebody, I don't know, because I sure. I lived around Hudson Lake, so mm-hmm. it's like I don't really think people are really out there like that, so I'm like, I don't know. So I was like in between two lakes, so I'm just like sheesh, you know, they thought something happened in the pond, and I'm over here like I walk by a pond and I'm like like I wouldn't
like anything could come out of there.
Yeah, and then I would walk at night too mm-hmm. because, you know, like we would walk to the lake to go to the bigger lake mm-hmm. you know, with my kids, and then so when we're walking back home and I'm walking by this one, I'm like
yeah,
like what if something comes and gets me.
Yeah,
so no, I'm okay. But yeah, so it kind of reminded me of that, and I was like, yeah, no, I'm okay. But I don't know, but the nanny, yeah, Ursula.
Yeah.
It just, it's, was this supposed to be like Little Mermaid?
Little Mermaid, what do you mean?
This isn't the Little Mermaid.
Oh, Ursula. Ursula. I was like, right. What? Yeah, Ursula Moncton.
And then it just, yeah,
name.
I was going to say.
She's, yeah, she's up. Okay, spoilers abound. Go ahead. Like, she's not really a human being.
Yeah.
So much.
She's a.
Though I'd say that the way that everything is written in this book, it kind of leaves it open to imagination, because sometimes I would feel this feeling of, okay, it's all just pretend. It's all just the way that this little kid is like explaining a weird situation to himself. Like it almost felt like it does when you're a kid and your imagination is so vivid that you can kind of convince yourself that things are real sometimes. So I kind of went back and forth between like he's telling a real supernatural story to, no, it's just this kid's imagination. Wild imagination. And you don't really ever know if which one is the correct way to view it, you know
yeah,
what I mean?
Because like the one thing that I used to remember getting told when I was little was never forget how you were when you were young. Mm-hmm. And I never, like, I was like, okay. But then now I get that, because like, all right, you punish your kids and mm-hmm. you're just like, wait, you have to remember they are little people.
Right.
Your job is to raise them, and they don't, sometimes they don't know what's good from bad. So you're
right.
just like, all right, you have to remember how it was young. How did you feel?
Right.
So like with my, you know, daughter, I have to like think like that, so
yeah.
It's just, I'm just like, all right, you gotta chill.
Yeah. Yeah, so some of the things that even like happened to this kid, and I mean, you know, it's, he's not really even that scared at first, even though crazy stuff happens, like he wakes up and there's like a coin in his throat, like that's freaked me out. Or the part where he's pulling the worm out of his foot, and he's just like, maybe everybody gets worms in their foot. I don't know. Like,
but see, that's what I mean. Like, yeah, kids are so in it. Like, yeah. they don't know what's normal until you tell them. Because even I struggle with that as an adult. You know, as an adult, you turn 18, boom, and then you have to figure out yourself.
Don't remind me.
And so, like, that's kind of what it is with kids. Yeah, they don't know, you know, what's real, what's not. Yeah. Like, you know, because I remember seeing weird little stuff when I was little, and I was like, wait, what is that? And until you ask, you know, and get your answer, you know, your question answered, I mean, like, you're not going to know. Like, well, little kids, at least. Like, they're just, like, and then some of the things that, like, I don't know, the way the kids, their thinking process is just, I love it, though, sometimes, because, like, it's so weird. There was one time my daughter had, like, mosquito bites when she was, like, little, and she's like, look, Mom, I have little boobies everywhere, and I was like, no, I was like, those are mosquito bites. She's like, what is that? And I was like, oh, my goodness. I was like, okay, never mind, but that's, like, it brings you into the innocence. They don't know anything. Right. Yeah. They're trying to piece the world together, like, you know? So that's, so I felt for the little kid.
Well, I think you're kind of right. That's a little bit what the story is kind of about. And I was listening to a little bit of Neil Gaiman talking about writing this book. And by the way, there's also on Hoopla, I think it's one of these masterclass things. So he kind of talks about writing and about his process writing. And they're really cool. Like, each one's about 15 minutes or so. And it's just him sitting in front of a camera just talking about his process, his creative ideas and things like that. But in particular with this one, he was just kind of going off of, the world is a very confusing and scary place, and you have to figure it out, like, as you go along. And also, I think there's a quote somewhere about, like, we're, and maybe it's in Coraline or maybe it's in something else, that, like, adults are not really any different than kids in a way. Like, we're still have that sense of we don't really know, you know.
There's not a manual to life.
Yeah, and as a child, you think all adults have all the answers, but then you just kind of grow up and realize that you never get all the answers.
You're always still figuring it out.
Yeah, so I think that's kind of at the heart of what scary things are, is just the unknown, and that we can't know.
I don't like spooky, because I don't like the unknown. My anxiety says, nope, you're good.
Yeah.
Nope. Mm-hmm.
I really liked something that wasn't mentioned, was the writing style of the narrator.
Yeah.
Because the narrator is, the narration is kind of choppy, unreliable. And it also is, like, kind of fragmented and selective. And I thought that was really cool, because it puts a piece of the character in the book as the writing style. And I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, no, I think I know what you mean, because, like, sometimes it almost switches really quickly because, like, his memory isn't quite... I don't know. It's almost like he's being tricked. He's like, I thought there was three women, but now there's only two or something, you know, and it just keeps going. Yeah, I liked that, too. Unreliable is an interesting way to put it. So you know things maybe that even the narrator doesn't know, and it's kind of fun in that way.
Ha-ha, I one-upped you.
Yeah. So, again, then you're never sure. Is it a trick of his mind, or is it really something magical happening? Like, I really liked that uncertainty.
Psychological thrillers.
Scary.
All right, so this is definitely a book I would recommend that you come, and we do have a copy here. We have the audiobook version. It's just a short little one. If you've got a weekend and it's cold outside and it's kind of creepy, it's a perfect book to curl up with and just enjoy. So thank you guys for checking it out with me. All right, we've gotten to the main event.
All right, Bobby.
I've got something
I like it.
To cue it up for us. Here we go.
Before there was Casper.
Look!
It's the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
Before there was Flubber.
Whoa!
Before there was Men in Black.
Hey, anybody see a ghost?
There were only...
What the hell are you doing?
The Ghostbusters.
The city is headed for a disaster of biblical proportion.
Fire and brimstone, earthquakes, volcanoes,
dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria.
Get out, I get the point.
Celebrate the 15th anniversary.
We're going to play Twister. We're going to do some breakdancing.
Of one of the funniest movies of all time.
What are you supposed to be, some kind of a cosmonaut?
No, we're exterminators. Somebody saw a cockroach up on 12.
Ghostbusters, the movie that scared us with spirits.
Generally, you don't see that kind of behavior in a major appliance.
Wowed us with gadgets.
Nice shooting, Tex.
And covered us with slime.
He slimed me. I feel so funky.
Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Sigourney Weaver, Harold Ramis, Rick Moranis, Annie Potts, Ernie Hudson, in a film by Ivan Reitman.
You have been a participant in the biggest interdimensional cross-rip since the Tunguska blast of 1909.
Felt great. Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah. All right, Bobby, tell us what we're talking about.
Wow, that just brings back a lot of memories. I was about laughing through the whole thing because you just heard the different parts come up. And I more or less turned it into like trivia, and then I get to thinking. I look at the group I'm sitting here with, and I'm going like, were they even alive?
Well, actually, so you heard in that clip, I picked that particular trailer just because it was a lot of fun.
Right.
But it said 15th anniversary. Yeah. That is definitely not true anymore. Right. This year is the 40th anniversary of the original 1984 Ghostbusters. Yes.
So two of us were alive at that time. I won't say any names.
I was born that year. It was a very good year. Yes.
Really? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
I was not. I was born 10 years later.
I was born a million years later.
Yes. So we're just talking about, or at least I only prepared to talk about the first original Ghostbusters. Right. But yes. That's what we're going to do.
Well, I tell you, what I sort of did was I wanted to turn it in for everybody here, sort of turn it into just a game.
Okay.
Just to see who would win. Because everybody, if you're anybody, you have seen the original Ghostbusters. I mean, you've never seen the original.
No, let me confess. So I did watch Ghostbusters, but because of the podcast, it's the first time
I've never watched it. I'm so glad we were able to give you this gift of watching Ghostbusters.
That is
I'm going to be really curious to know what your thoughts were watching it for the first time.
So I did watch it, but I was like, okay, because I always remember that guy, Bill Murray.
Is he the one?
Him, every time he's in a movie, I'm like, all right, what is this going to be about? Like, you know, which is a good thing. But I, because I honestly watched it last night because I thought I could watch it on my streaming services. Nope, get your physical copy at the library.
Come and get it here.
They told me it was available. It lied to me. Mm-hmm. So I had to check it out here. And so I was able to watch it and I was like, okay, because obviously, first things first, I don't really watch DVDs a lot. So I had it in, you know, I played and then I was putting my kids to bed so I can concentrate on the movie. And I just laugh because it just keeps playing the Ghostbusters theme song over and over and over. Yeah. So, but I'm like, only like 90s kids and like beyond understand that, like, if you leave a DVD playing, it's just going to keep going and going. And so that was like the first thing. And I just kind of laughed and I'm like, okay. So I play it and then it starts and I was like, oh, Bobby, you picked this because it's a horror movie that starts at the library.
No human being would stack books like this.
Yeah, exactly. That part made me laugh.
You know
so
what else
hard?
Too? My husband made fun of me because you know when he's wiping the slime on the books and I'm like, come on, man. And he's like, calm down, library.
Right. This is your book. Yeah. No, but it was really funny. But that at first I was just laughing at that part. I was like, he would pick this because it's at a library.
Sure, yeah.
And then, you know, they get to, you know, the ads and stuff. And it's the 90s humor is crazy. Well, this is 80s.
80s humor. Yeah. Yeah.
80s humor was pretty crazy. And I miss it because I'm like, the stuff now, I'm like, you can't say half the stuff you can in the movies. And so I was like, okay. I was like, I'm loving this.
Yeah.
And then, like, you see he was eating, like, Cheez-Its, and it literally says Cheez-Its. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I miss all that. And so anyway, so, you know, they do their second job. Spoiler, and they're at the little dining area. Oh, no, I don't care how much money. You they destroy. Oh, that, the yes. Yeah. And then how do you prove that you actually, like, you captured a ghost? Like, all
he's smoking. He's holding it. It's right there.
It's right. Yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean, I could have just gave you a smoke machine and be like, look, I got a ghost, guys.
If Ray Stantz says that you've got a ghost, you've got a ghost. You can trust okay. this guy. The heart and soul of the Ghostbusters.
But I loved it. It was funny. Like, you know, it was really cute. You know, obviously it's catchy because of the song, but it's really awesome. Like, it was cool vibes. Like, yeah, it's not spooky, but it was like funny spooky. Like, it's still a good like Halloween kind of movie.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, okay, now I get why people kind of wear it. But if like the costumes, if I ever wore one and I seen a ghost, I would just start whacking them or something.
It was such a thing. Like, Ghostbusters stuff was just everywhere. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, some interesting question for you guys. All right. So you remember the very first ghost that was in the library.
Mm-hmm.
And that was actually in one of the New York libraries.
The main branch of the New York Public Library. Yep.
So, do you remember the first ghost, the green ghost, the little green ghost?
I thought it was purple.
You mean Slimer?
Yes. Right. But the interesting thing, the reason that I'm not saying that was, what do you think? He was never called Slimer.
No, not in the movie.
In the original movie.
Yeah, I can't remember when he started being called that. I remember it for sure from the cartoon that happened
that
later.
That is exactly
is that when it happened?
Okay. So when the real Ghostbusters, which was a cartoon that sort of followed the characters, when that came out, they started calling him Slimer.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, what do you know him as? His actually original name was Onion Head.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Isn't that the goofiest? I go, like, where do you get? I mean, he was my kids drank Slimer, the little.
Oh yeah,
the,
yeah, yeah.
So I mean, that was just the end thing. But the interesting thing, what always interested me about movies is to read like who tried out for or who they
wrote who the parts for. Okay, I did know one of them because of John Belushi.
John Belushi,
right?
Yeah.
Which sadly he died a couple years before it started.
And the interesting thing was Winston,
okay,
which actually didn't come in until later in the movie when it was originally written. Do you know who they wanted? He was he was actually the biggest star in the world at that time, Eddie Murphy.
Oh, okay. I was going to say like Richard Pryor or something, but maybe he was a little bit older.
Eddie Murphy. Yeah. And they wanted Eddie Murphy, and they actually wanted John Belushi, of course, to play Venkman.
Okay. Yeah.
Which was – and then for Louis Tully,
I can't imagine anybody but Rick Moranis playing him. He was so much better than I remembered funny he was.
Do you know who they wanted to play that?
No.
Another guy that died.
Oh,
John. I'm sorry. Spooky. I'm sorry. John Candy.
Really? That would have been a very different.
Well, he said he had pictured it at the time. He had pictured it that he would be a German guy that had dogs, and I was like, there was so much. I'm not going to say freelancing, but ad-libbing.
Yeah.
That I don't even know. I mean, you imagine. Bill Murray, and you imagine.
Sure, yeah, he probably just made up a lot of that stuff on the spot. Yeah.
All of these guys, they were just making things all like crossing the streams.
That was just made up. Really?
Like, how much worse can it be?
Yeah.
But speaking of that, now the song, you've got that song sort of stuck in your head.
Mm-hmm. You I was literally dead.
Right. Yeah. So that actually, they were sued over that song. Do you know what song?
I can't remember the song. It was definitely Huey Lewis in the News.
Yes, it was.
But I can't remember what was the one that it supposedly sounded like.
I Want a New Drug.
I Want a New
Drug. And if you listen to it, you go like, oh, I can hear it. Yeah. I can hear it.
Well, didn't they want Huey Lewis and the News to do a song? And then they were like, no.
Yeah,
and
so they had just recently done a movie song, and they...
Was it for Back to the Future? Or no, that was...
I think it was Back to the Future.
Did that come out after this? I don't know.
Yeah.
It's in the same ballpark,
At the time, movie-wise, I mean, the budget for the movie, they said how much... asked Ivan how much he could make the movie. He said $30 million, which today, in today's basis, $30 million for a
it's
movie
just nothing.
Is... Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it ended up being the second most grossing movie of 1984 at about $264 million, which is, in today's standards, is pennies.
Yeah.
So, but interesting. I mean, just a lot of the, like the Stay Puft. Mm-hmm. I mean, how much more remarkable...
Yeah.
You know, they had to clear their minds. so they could everybody clear your minds. Right. Everybody clear your minds. Okay, you're gonna decide who the destructor is.
Right.
Now Grant's really over here going scene. Like, I have no idea what they're talking about. You well, you,
did
watch
you
it.
Did you watch the movie?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Okay. I'm curious what a young person thinks of the special effects, because I know that, I mean, at the time.
Right. Oh, it was amazing.
Blew everybody away.
Yeah.
Like corny. The proton packs.
Yeah.
It's very corny.
Yeah.
I'm used to it, so you can't really ask me. Yeah. I'm like, I watched, you know, I was born in the 90s, mm-hmm. so I watched stuff like that. So I'm like, oh.
I don't know. I'm just so used to, like, such cool special effects where, like.
HD.
I'm where I'm different is I like even further back in that. I mean, I like Godzilla's.
Sure, and
things
yeah.
like that, to where there was a guy in a suit.
Yeah. Well, there was a guy in the Stay Puffed Marshmallow suit, right? Yeah, like, it was just somebody stomping around, and that was kind of how they did that. So.
Now, the interesting thing is, who was he designed? I mean, I want you to think about brands.
Well, he looks like, always looked like the Michelin man.
Okay. That's good. She's good. Yeah, that was one of them. And then the...
Oh, Pillsbury Doughboy. I forgot about
him. She's a commercial. I'm done.
You couldn't escape this stuff, though, when we were... I wish everyone could see that Bobby's poking himself in his stomach.
I know you can't see it, but... Because you had to poke the... But the Michelin man, if you look at the Michelin man...
Yeah, definitely.
And then you go, like, wow. They really... just the movie itself, but... Actually, the interesting thing is they wanted, like I said, Eddie Murphy to play Winston.
Yeah, Winston has a pretty small part in the first movie.
And the reason that he did was because they were going to build the movie around Eddie Murphy.
Oh,
because at the time, he was Beverly Hills Cop was actually the number one movie at that time.
Okay.
And they were going to sort of build the movie around him. And then when he wouldn't do it, because he, guess what, number one movie that year was Beverly Hills Cop.
Oh, okay.
So
he was just busy? That's why he didn't do it?
Well, we can't get you. Oh, you know,
I wonder if he regrets that one.
Well, and that's what I was going. But, you know, the guy that played Winston, I mean.
Ernie Hudson.
Ernie Hudson, mm-hmm. amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Did I think he was here locally recently.
Yes.
He was up in Benton Harbor. Or isn't he from around here?
I thought he was.
He might be.
I'm not. But
Ernie Hudson, the guy who played Winston.
He's played in, like, some... I mean, a lot of different things, but off the top of my head. But,
yeah,
very good actor, and they brought him in, and they ended up pulling his, you know, like, oh, we're so busy, we got to hire somebody else.
Yeah.
And he says, for a paycheck, because he says, well, make it.
Right, so he gets to be kind of the everyman of just like, I don't know what the heck's going on, but fine, I'll go.
For a paycheck?
Yeah, I'll go catch some ghosts. Let's go.
All right.
So the interesting thing, do you remember at the end, Karen, when there was the big – they blew up the Stay Puft. They crossed the streams, right? So what do you think they used for marshmallow? Because remember, they dumped it on
everybody. I
kind of
wondered this. I don't know the answer to this, but I did wonder it as I was watching
it.
I
don't know.
Yeah, it was actually shaving cream.
Just tons and tons of shaving cream.
And they actually took, I thought they had said, I read 50 gallons. And they had a stuntman, because the guy that played the sort of the bad guy in it, that was trying to shut the grid off. They said, "Well, how do we get, you know, test this?" So they get a stuntman, and they dump 50 gallons or 70 gallons of shaving cream on him, and it knocked him to the ground. And he says, "Well, we sort of got a maybe not so much."
Maybe so a they little bring less.
In
a,
but it was they were using 500 gallons of shaving cream.
The shaving cream budget on this movie must have been.
The shaving cream company's like, yes. But I the one thing, though, with this movie, the ghost reminded me of my toddlers, and I didn't like that. Because they kept going, like, the dining room scene just keeps going in my head when they're just, like, running around, and they're just, like, destroying the whole thing. And I'm just like, that's me when I'm trying to change their diaper, and they're trying to run away from me. I'm like, get over here. Yeah. Like
that first scene where they run through the hotel and they destroy basically the hotel. And I don't know why, but it struck me as so funny this time. I think it's the first time that they use the proton packs and they throw throw the things. Right. And they hit the woman with the cleaning cart. And then she just comes out. I actually was in the clip. I was so happy. She's like, what the hell are you doing? I thought that was like the funniest line in the entire movie.
I guarantee you. I mean, as I'm learning, was learning more and more about it because it just fascinated me is that they just – everybody was just throwing lines and every go that really works, you know. And if you watch the, you know, Dan Aykroyd and you watch the different actors, oh my God, just so talented. And just, I don't even know if any of it was scripted. They just were just going off cuff a lot of times. I love Sigourney Weaver.
No, actually, I did want to mention her because I think that she kind of elevates the movie, being that she was an alien and she's like really tough. Like, it makes it feel more substantial because she's not just the, oh, damsel in distress. Like, you kind of get this feeling from her. Like, she could handle herself a little bit, so this is pretty bad. Like, I don't know. I really enjoyed her a lot. I think Rick Moranis steals the show many times. I love it when he's running around and he goes and talks to the horse and he's like, are you the Keymaster?
But the interesting thing about him was is almost everything that he did was ad-lib.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me.
And his own costumes and everything was his.
Keeps getting locked out of his apartment.
But the interesting thing about Sigourney Weaver is she came from a very prestigious and she was she had done a lot of on Broadway, off Broadway type stuff, and she was from Yale. And you know they're going like, oh, we're not going to land anybody like this. And in her whenever she was trying out for the part, she actually got up to the because she had read the one part to where she was talking about this. The thing with the Keymaster.
And she actually
got up and crawled up and barked like a dog. And the guy's going like, I think we found our person, you know. And she, but
so she's a dog.
Oh, it's not. And one of my favorite lines is towards the end where they go, oh, it smells like burnt dog.
And he goes, oh, I'm sorry,
Oh, I'm so sorry, Pinkman, for your. But other things like now. What was the original name of the movie? Because, see, you have to understand.
I've heard this one, but I don't know if I'm going to remember it now.
In 1975, there was actually a TV show. And a guy named Forrest Tucker, which is like into the Westerns back in the 50s and 60s, and Ted Knight was in it. And so they originally couldn't get the movie Ghostbusters. So I'm going to give you guys three names.
Good to get choices.
And then you get to pick two of them. All right? So two of them are correct.
Two are correct. Yeah. Okay.
Ghost Smashers, Ghost Breakers, and Ghost Chasers.
Oh, man.
Ghost Chasers and Ghost
I was going to say Ghost Chasers. Smashers. I'm going to go with one of them. Okay. And Smashers? What was the middle?
Breakers
and Smashers.
I bet Smashers and Chasers.
See, I'm going Breakers and Chasers.
Well, you're right. Smashers and Breakers.
Completely wrong. So Chasers wasn't one of them?
Correct. Yeah, I made that up. I was going, what are they doing? Oh, they're chasing.
Well, they should have hired you to name their show. That's a better name.
But, yeah, so they ended up, were able to go with Ghostbusters. And, of course, the whole thing with, we had talked about earlier with the music was Huey Lewis and the News. Yeah. And they ended up doing an out-of-court settlement. So we're not sure how much money they made out of that. So everybody sues you. Then one of the last things I have is Ecto-1. Everybody remembers the car. Classic car, right? All right, so it's one of these. It was it a 59 Cadillac? Was it a 72 Hearse? Because a lot of, well, at that time, Hearse was a big manufacturer of and then also a 68 Demers.
Karen, you're a car gal.
I'm trying
to. I bet it was a Hearse. It looks like a Hearse.
And it's, it's not. It's a Cadillac.
Really?
But I thought you meant Hearse, like as in, you know.
It was a brand at one time.
Oh,
it was ones that were the funeral cars.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, so that's why they're called that.
Yeah.
Oh,
Yeah, so it's actually a brand of car.
So you said it was a Cadillac?
It was a Cadillac.
Cadillac made something, because it looked like a station wagon.
Yeah. I mean, everybody made a station wagon back in the day. Now nobody does.
I had a station wagon.
Those were great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
grocery getters.
The seat in the back where you look at, you face the other way.
That was never me.
Yeah.
Well, I have to say what they did during our time was we stood in the back everywhere we went. Oh. All the kids are standing in the back. Do you remember that? Or did you have to be
I did because my dad drove a cargo van that he just bolted some seats in. And so if the seat didn't happen to be in there at the time, he's like, well, hop in. And we just go anyway.
Stand up. Yeah. You stand up on the seats and you go like, we're so safe. All
right, whatever.
Right. We're so safe. Right. And especially in the back of a pickup truck.
Yeah.
I've been in a back. To do that. That's fun. Being in a back. I did that on Beaver Island.
Beaver Island?
You guys have never heard of Beaver Island?
I have. I haven't been. It's up in... near
it's up in Lake Michigan.
Yeah,
see, nope.
No, I know where it is. Yeah, it's near Traverse City, right?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah, no, see, I you take a ferry.
I never went on the ferry. I didn't get up early enough when I was up there. But yeah, well, Ghostbusters is a fantastic movie. You really can't get better than Ghostbusters. Yeah. It's a good excuse to just watch it.
Periodically, we just pull it. Julie and I'll pull it out. I says, you gotta watch it because you'll just sit the whole time. Because Bill Murray
he's Bill Murray.
He's so Bill Murray. Even in when
he's
did
the Bill Murray-est.
What's the one with the zombies?
Zombieland. He's just barely in that, but it's hilarious.
The whole time I'm
that
going,
been a good one too.
He's just making this up. Yeah. He's just making it all up. It's just the way he is.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I had so much fun watching this again. So have we left anything?
Yes.
We got more to say.
I actually brought us
something. That's right. We have some Ghostbusters Krispy Kreme donuts here in front of us.
Sponsored.
I'm not sponsored, but they released Ghostbuster themed donuts.
So what do they look like?
I wish everyone could see this.
So
Slimer. We got Stay Puffed.
We each get one, and then the staff can have the rest. I thought it was funny because the face was like starting to melt off. It's all the little it's like the little signs and stuff. So I was like, okay, I have to get it for us. I was like, I just have to. I don't know, you can, because I don't know who's who.
This is cool. So we definitely encourage you to rent the movie from the library or check out the movie from the library. Go get yourself some Krispy Kremes and have a great time this weekend with some Ghostbusters action. All right, so thank you, everyone, talking with us. We do have one more little thing to leave on our little moment of library joy. So I wanted to share something with you guys. Check this out.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Lincoln Township Public Library's podcast, Beyond the Stacks. I am Brian Johnston, the Adult Services Librarian here, and with me is my co-host, Amy Nolan, Children's Librarian. Amy, how are you doing today?
Couldn't be better. Really excited to be here.
Wonderful. Yeah, so the purpose of this podcast is to provide our patrons with some interesting local information that can help them in a variety of ways. Right now, as some of you might be aware, we are currently closed. Our main building is closed due to...
Okay, so that was just a little taste of the first episode of Lincoln Township's new podcast, Beyond the Stacks. Mm-hmm. So I just want to welcome Lincoln Township Public Library to the podcast club. I actually got to talk to Brian Johnson for just a minute, maybe about a month ago, as he was getting ready to start doing the podcast. He had some technical questions. He'd heard about our podcast, and so he called me up to see if he could get some tips. And so I'm really happy that Lincoln Township is going to be doing this now. So I would encourage everybody out there, if you want to check it out. Lincoln Township is a very cool library. They've also been coming here with their mobile legal aid program every couple of weeks and offering some great free legal advice. So they're a cool library. They're up usually on John Beers Road, but they are temporarily in another location for a little while. But yeah, so I just wanted to share that we've got a new podcast buddy, and I think we should reach out to them and maybe do some
a collab.
I think so too. Ooh, we should have a super podcast one of these days.
Awesome. We just need the equipment for that.
Yeah. So just wanted to share the library love a little bit. Next week, I'm going to be going to the Michigan Library Association Conference. And that's always fun to get to see what all the other libraries around the state are doing, which is a million cool things. So I just wanted to just plug for a minute, one of our library buddies in the area, and just say that that gave me some library joy this month to know that we've got buddies out there. So
yeah,
all right,
podcast buddies.
Yep. All right. Well, thank you guys for bringing your creepy picks today, and especially thank you to Bobby
for being here. Thank you.
I know we've got to let you go now because you got to go get your fire truck.
Yeah, gotta get the fire truck.
So, okay, thank you everyone, and we will see you again with another episode soon. So,
bye. See you later.
Thank you for listening to the Dewey Decibel System, the official podcast of the Buchanan District Library. Thanks as well to our special guest, Bobby Blaylock, for joining us today. Our theme music was written and performed by Miguel Perez, a.k.a. Dogzilla, and this episode was recorded at the Buchanan District Library on October 8, 2024. You can learn more about the library by visiting buchananlibrary.org or stopping in to see us in downtown Buchanan, Michigan.